Please join with me in the call to worship. Come and worship, people of God, with praises on your lips. Even when we are feeling isolated and fearful, we can glorify the one who holds our hands in our loneliness. As you come into the presence of the one who makes holy every place, every space, holy and sacred, and even when we continue to stay safe in our homes, the doors of grace are flung wide open for us. Let us come and hear the stories of the one who loves you, whether in our living rooms, on our laptops or devices. We will sing your songs and tell those tales of the peace and of the hope which is ours.
Gracious loving God, we come to you this day, for this is the day that you have made, and we rejoice and we're glad to be in it. While we're not together with you in person this morning worshiping, we worship with you virtually through the gifts of the Spirit of God that you bring. So be with us now as we worship with you through your Son, Jesus the Christ. Amen. Good morning and welcome to online worship with Milwaukee Metropolitan Community Church. While we're still not able to worship in person, I'm glad that you've joined us online this morning to be a part of this worship and this congregation. Lots has happened over the course of the week in our community, in our world, as well as our state, and know that as a church community that we still are looking out for the best interests of this congregation. So while we may still have to worship virtually for a while longer, we still are glad that you are with us this morning. As we continue to come together each and every day, know that we are looking after the safety of everybody that is vulnerable in our congregation as well as the community. So continue worshiping with us this way, and hopefully soon we'll be back together. So as we continue with this worship this morning, let us hear God's word.
Our epistle lesson this morning comes from the book of Acts, chapter 17, verses 22 through 31, taken from the Inclusive Bible. Then Paul stood up before the council of Areopagus and delivered this address. Citizen of Athens, I note that in every respect you are scrupulously religious. As I walked about looking at your shrines, I even discovered an altar inscribed to an unknown god. Now, what you are worshiping in ignorance, I intend to make known to you. For the God who made the world and all that is in it, the sovereign on heaven and earth, doesn't live in sanctuaries made by human hands and isn't served by humans as if in need of anything. No, the God is the one who gives everyone life, breath, everything. From one person, God created all of humankind to inhabit the entire earth and set the time for each nation to exist and the exact place where each nation should dwell. God did this so that human beings would seek, reach out for, and perhaps find the one who is not really far from any of us, the one in whom we live and move and have our being. As one of your poets has put it, we too are God's children. If we are in fact children of God, then it's inexcusable to think that the divine nature is like an image of gold, silver, or stone, an image formed by the art and thought of mortals. God, who overlooked such ignorance in the past, now commands all people everywhere to reform their lives. For a day has been set when the whole earth will be judged with justice. And this judge, who is a human being, has already been appointed. God has given proof of all of this by raising the judge from the dead. May God bless the hearing of these words.
This morning comes from 1 John chapter 4, verses 10 through 19, taken from the Inclusive Bible. Love, then, consists of this: not that we have loved God, but that God has loved us and has sent the only begotten to be an offering for our sins. Beloved, if God has so loved us, we must have the same love for one another. No one has ever seen God. Yet if we love one another, God dwells in us, and God's love is brought to perfection in us. The way we know that we remain in God, and God in us, is that we have been given the Spirit. We have seen for ourselves and can testify that God has sent the only begotten as Savior of our world. When any acknowledge that Jesus is the only begotten, God dwells in them, and they in God. We have come to know and to believe in the love God has for us. God is love, and those who abide in love abide in God, and God in them. Love will come to perfection in us when we can face the day of judgment without fear, because our relation to this world is just like Christ. There is no fear in love, for perfect love drives out fear. To fear is to expect punishment, and anyone who is afraid is still imperfect in love. We love because God first loved us. Hear what the Spirit says today. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Will you come to prayer with me this morning? Gracious, loving God, we know that just because we're not together in this building together, that you are with us through your Spirit of love. We know that just because this church isn't active and open, that you are active and open in our hearts through our homes and as we come together virtually. You continue to show us that this church is still alive and going, and that we continue to be undefeated. Whether we are together or apart, you continue to be that gift in our lives. So I ask now that you would mold my lips of clay and touch my heart as we hear the words that are spoken this morning, and the words that come from my mouth along with the meditations of all our hearts. Let them be ever acceptable to you. In Christ we pray. So over the past several weeks, we have been engaged in this sermon series called The Gospel According to Pixar. We've come to discover that these films are a part of our lives, that they touch our hearts while stirring our souls and while engaging our minds, along with the incredible ability to make us laugh, all at the same time. I hope you've been allowing yourself to engage in the series and enjoying it, and hopefully watching some of these films, if even for the first time. I had someone share with me last week that they had been given a completely different perspective and outlook on these films through the messages that we've brought. And the same person, who I will remain nameless, also offered their view to tell me that these themes of the film offer this rich and deep perspective, and sometimes wanting more. Now, I'm not sure if that indication of wanting more was for me to preach longer on a Sunday morning, but my gut tells me that it's possible that that indication is to go much deeper into the message and maybe to go a little bit more outside of the box. A lot of times we think of these movies as being children's movies, but we know that oftentimes that they've been written with a much wider audience in mind. This morning we're going to take a look at Monsters, Inc., which until I watched it again, gave me a much deeper appreciation for this particular Pixar movie. I have to take in time and look at the opportunities as we watch these movies. I hope that you do take that time to look at them, to allow yourself to get more connected with the message as we continue on each week. I feel that one of the most important messages that comes from this particular movie is the relationship between love and fear. We hear in 1 John this morning that we assume that this is a part of scripture that was written by the same author of the Gospel of John. But in 1 John is one of those three letters that were written at the end of the Gospels of the New Testament. So we assume, but we're not really sure, only because there is still that debate who the actual writer of this passage was. But the good thing about 1 John, as well as all the scriptures that come from the Johns, is that the Greek is relatively a simplistic gift. It is easy to digest and to understand the words that come out of John's Gospels. We need to somewhat assume that this particular letter of John is being written to one of the churches, that it may be a bit of a conflict and even maybe some disagreement. I think at some point that people were maybe missing the point, because this particular portion of scripture was sharing the point of loving one another. So as we continue, let's take a quick look at this week's clip from Monsters, Inc.
The creators of Toy Story.
Good morning, fellas.
Hey, what's shaking, bacon?
Did you lose weight or a limb?
Take you into the world behind your closet door.
Roz, you're looking fabulous today. Is that a new haircut? New makeup. You've had a lift. You've had a tuck. You've had something.
We've always been afraid monsters were there.
Scary feet, scary feet, scary feet. Oh, the kid's awake.
Waiting to scare us.
Twins and a bunk bed.
But what we didn't know is that we scare them.
What happened?
The kid almost touched me.
You can't touch a child. They're toxic. If a kid ever got through one of our doors, the results would be catastrophic.
Tuck it.
Walt Disney Pictures presents...
Kitty!
That thing is a killing machine!
A Pixar Animation Studios film.
There's a kid here! A human kid!
We can neither confirm nor deny the presence of a human child.
Let's keep it. I always wanted a pet that could kill me!
Five, four.
What are you doing?
Monsters Incorporated.
It's a musical.
put that thing back where it came from, or so help me. So help me, so help me, and cut.
So Monsters, Inc., for those of you who didn't have a chance to preview the film before this morning, is a film about Sully and his buddy Mike, who are monsters living in the city of Monstropolis. And for work, they work at the factory in Monstropolis called Monsters, Inc. And Monsters, Inc. is this company that provides the fuel for Monstropolis. And how they are able to get that fuel and manage the city is to go into children's rooms at night and scare the heebie-jeebies out of them to make them scream. You see, it's those screams that are converted into that energy and then fuels the entire city of Monstropolis. Now, keep up with me here. I think you might be caught up with everything if you have been watching the movie, but of course, that one of these children who they are trying to scare, and by the way, they kindly are out there to make them afraid, so they cry and they scream louder, but somehow escapes her bedroom and comes into the world of the monsters. Interestingly enough, that these children are innocent and loving, and the monsters are scary and frightening. They somewhat, though, have it backwards because the monsters are completely afraid of the children. Now, as one of these children creep into the monster world and over the duration of the movie, Mike and Sully develop this affection for this little girl, all at the same time transforming how they now see the world. I have to say that just to love the characters in this film, because only a Sully, if you know, and if you knew who played it, but Sully is the voice of John Goodman, and Mike is the voice of Billy Crystal. And of course, you can't forget Boo, who is that adorable little girl that is one of the Pixar characters that you instantly fall in love with. In my opinion, the premiere of this movie was absolutely brilliant. I mean, come now, you have to start out by saying, what child isn't afraid of the dark? And if you tell me that you were never afraid of the dark when you were a kid, well, I think we need to have a little talk at some point. But being afraid of the dark and that there isn't this monster hiding in the closet or under the bed isn't everything that some child has experienced in life. I can tell you that my godsons, when they were smaller, had some kind of nightlight or something when they went to bed. I just have to say that they're both now 7, and I'm sure hoping that they're not using a nightlight, but, you know, it makes me want to look at things in a different perspective. And you know those lights don't go out until everybody's asleep, and just in case you didn't know, they don't go out until we're all in bed. But then as adults, we somewhat grow out of that. I mean, I hope we do. I mean, we're not afraid anymore, right? I mean, come on, there are lots of things that we are afraid of in life, just as our monsters look a little different. The monsters in our childhood now become a different type of monster in real life. There is one author out there in the world who says, fear makes adults defensive and controlling. Children simply scream. It's more of a direct emotional and physical action, and probably a more healthier one. Children scream. Adults get controlling and defensive. And I will say we sadly know that to be true. But what we see in this movie and what we seem to know to be true in our lives is that too often fear becomes an incredibly powerful tool or a very powerful fuel. That in many ways, that much like the residents of Monstropolis, fear is what fuels us. Because we are literally a culture that runs on fear. I am amazed at all the things that so many of us are afraid of. Did you know that the number one fear people have is public speaking? Those of you who know who Jerry Seinfeld is, in one of his comedy acts, he says public speaking is the number one fear, and that people have that fear in their lives constantly. But the number two biggest fear is death. So I guess if you ever go to a funeral, you probably are better off maybe being in the casket than delivering the eulogy. I'm just saying that number one, public speaking, and number two, death. There is also this thing called the fear of success. People out in the world are really afraid of becoming successful in life. Jerry Steinfeld continues to say that in that case, then we are really scraping the bottom of the fear barrel if we are fearing the one thing that we all desperately want, success. Sadly, if we look at things, fear has become the narrative of the day. I mean, look at the world that we've been living in over the last 2 months. We've been living in a world of fear due to this COVID-19 pandemic, and rightfully so in many ways. I mean, every time we turn on the news, we hear the things that can cause that fear and create that fear in our lives. Aside from that, we also hear that every day our lives, that there is something out there that we need to be fearful of. There, however, is this narrative that we hear over and over again, that fuel that is what's driving us. For all intents and purposes, we are a culture of faith that has turned into a culture of fear. The main difference in the world is that we have to take that culture that is turned and turn it around. But fear is what is driving us in life, sadly. Now, the irony of this movie is, which has brought us to this interesting twist, is what I also said earlier, is that Sully, the monster, is afraid of Boo. And I have to say that one of my favorite clips from this movie is this one particular one that Sully and Boo are together. So take a quick look. So, I mean, come now. Here we have Boo, this sweet, lovely little kid who now refers to Sully as Kitty. Boo sees him not as this humongous monster, but as this someone who is adorable and cute and like a kitty cat. She falls in love with him instantly, and we see that through the course of this movie that Sully becomes more and more lovable, not just to you, but to all of us, the audience. And the only reason that Sully becomes more lovable is because Boo deems him in that perspective. She sees him for who he really is, the core of a human being. Beyond that stereo appearance, beyond the role that he plays, but by going into children's room and scaring the screams out of them. But here we see Boo taking him as kind and affectionate, and even protective, and she loves him. Not that he will love her back, but not even loving her conditionally, but will love her unconditionally. Boo sees him for him, and for who he is, and from more of the inside out and the outside in. I think we can look at it as she loves him just as God loves us. Even in our scariest moments, our most vulnerable moments, God still loves us. and not so we will love God back, but simply because that's who God is. Love is based on conditions, and it really is all about the love. So through the rest of this movie, what we see is Sully being transformed by love. You see this power of love finding a way in him that changes him. But what is very profound in this way, because it is a way that is changing him, it's changing the people around him at the same time. And if you watch the entire movie, it changes how Monstropolis operates. And so what we see over and over again in the movie is this relationship of love and fear, which as we know it, are the two deepest emotions we experience as human beings. Both of these emotions have the ability to fuel us, to motivate us, and to affect the way we see the world. The way we relate with our neighbors, our friends, our spouses, our partners, it also has an effect in the way we make decisions, the way we create our world view. Now, both of these emotions play a huge part in how we live and go on with our lives. There is a famous quote from John Lennon, who once said, "There are two basic motivating forces, fear and love. When we are afraid, we pull back from life. When we love, we open ourselves to all that life has to offer with passion, excitement, and acceptance. Evolution and all hopes for a better world rest in the fearlessness, an open-hearted vision of people who embrace life." We can only look at it this way, that only when we are no longer afraid do we begin to live. And then there's our favorite Oprah Winfrey, the great chaplain of the spiritual but not the religious movement, who says this, "I believe that every single event in life happens in an opportunity to choose love over fear." So we see in the end, Sully chooses love. He chooses to risk everything in his life, and so he could get this sweet, adorable girl back to her home. He risked his job, he risked his friends, he risked everything he had in order to make sure that Boo was safe and out of the hands of the villains. He's transformed in this amazing way, and this isn't one of those big, sugary teddy bear stories. It's about the film of how love comes into perspective. It's also an adult film showing us how we love in different ways. This is a mature love that risks everything for another person, one that is not based on receiving, but loving for the sake of loving. There is a great Thein Buddhist monk by the name of Thich Nhat Hanh, and I'm hoping I'm pronouncing his name correctly, but he makes a profound statement that if our love is only a will to possess, it is not love. If we only think of ourselves, if we only are our own needs and ignore the needs of another person, we cannot love. We must look deeply in order to see and understand the needs, aspirations, and sufferings of the person we love. This is the ground of real love. So we see Sully finally getting Boo back home. So watch this real quick.
To scare you anymore, right? Yeah. Goodbye, Boo.
Kitty
has to go.
Now, I'm sure that last clip probably made you go run and get a Kleenex, because Sully's transformation from being a frightening, scary monster is now a fluffy, lovable kind of guy. And it's the theme of the movie that drives this story, that God wants nothing more for us to be home and safe and transformed by this unconditional love. Folks, while we all possess these qualities of unconditional love, we also have been living in a world of fear for almost 2 months now. This past week has yet changed the lives of all of us tremendously. And as we continue to transform how we live daily, we need to see and be transformed and how we can take those opportunities to be safe and to come back together. To provide that love, to help make sure that we're caring for the vulnerable. Showing that unconditional love by being safe. As I mentioned in the communication that went out to all of you this past Thursday, that in order for us to have this transformation to come back in person, we need to continue to make the transformation happen, to adhere to what we're being asked to do so we can go and have the gifts of being in a normal world once again. Know that as we live in these unprecedented times, that Milwaukee Metropolitan Community Church will not jeopardize any of you, and we will not resume in-person worship or gatherings or meeting until we feel it's deemed safe to do. We care about and love each of you just like Sully. We want to assure your safety and well-being. So when we have that opportunity to come back together, we can do it in a manner that is safe for each and every individual. As we heard at the end of the gospel reading this morning, there is no fear in love, for perfect love drives out fear. The fear is to expect punishment, and anyone who is afraid of it is still imperfect in love. We love because God first loved us. So as we continue to be safe and know that our blessings and gifts and prayers are with you, know that each and every one of us, from the staff to the board to myself, continue to pray for you each and every day. So blessings to each and every one of you this morning, Milwaukee Metropolitan Community Church. We hope to be together again soon. Amen.
As we come to this time of offering, I wanted to share with you that God has truly been loving and gracious to our little church. And it's through your faithfulness and through your tithing and through your giving that we are able to continue to bring you these services and to meet our obligations and pay our salaries and pay our bills. And so we are truly blessed as a congregation. Whether you worship with us regularly or you're worshiping with us online or today is the first time you worship, we invite you to take a moment and to support this ministry and support this church. You can simply mail in an offering or a gift to us. Some of you receive pastor's letter. There are envelopes in there that you can use, or you can go to our website or our Facebook and follow the link to PayPal to make a donation. And while you make those donations, I invite you to take a moment to pass the peace to one another virtually. Take a moment to pray. Take a minute to pray for an individual in the church or the whole church, and in that way, share God's love and pass the peace.
So as we come to the table this morning, I invite you, if you haven't already done so, to maybe grab some crackers or juice or some type of bread or wine or some type of element that represents communion for you this morning as we join together and we celebrate the gifts. The God we worship and the God we dance and sing about is the God who has proven God and God's self to us. Over and over again, we know that there would be times in our lives that we would need that blessed assurance and resurrected God in our lives. And so in that upper room on that evening and in the night that Jesus was to be taken from us, as he gathered at the table with the disciples, he took the bread, he blessed it and broke it and said to them, "To take and eat, as this is my body given for you. And often as you eat of this and from this, do so in remembrance of me." Likewise, at the meal, Jesus took the cup from the table, blessed it and said that this is the cup of the covenant of my life that is poured out for each and every individual, for all people, and the forgiveness of all of our sins. And drink from this often, and as often as you drink from this, do so in remembrance of me. So as we come together, will you pray with me? As your Spirit of truth comes in these moments to transform the bread and the cup and those who are gathered around the table, you show us how much you love us. As we are strengthened by the broken bread, you would send us to plant the hope in all the places where the pessimists have taken the root, to help love and stand on the corners where hate gangs are together. As you nourish us with the cup, you would have this place of peace in our hearts and bring healing to all who are broken. As we gather around this table of love with your sisters and brothers, with our enemies and friends seated side by side, as we pass grace to one another, we will join in forever singing your praises as we celebrate being who we are and through you, God and community, holy and one. Amen. So as this worship service comes to a close this morning, just remind yourselves that knowing that the building is not the church. We are the church. We are the church in our homes, in the community. We are the church out in the world. As we continue to move forward each and every day, know that our blessings and love are with you. So as we go out into the world this day and each and every day through God's tender mercies and love and protection that is given to each and every one of us, let us go out in the world through God the Creator, God the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.